Okay. Well, why don't I kick things off, Tom? I know this is going to be a wide-ranging discussion involving both of us, and my understanding is that we have about a 50-50 split here of Canadian industry, nuclear industry folks versus UK industry folks, and so I think the format and the pre-discussion that we had here, sharing information about how things are going in this post-COVID world for our respective nuclear industries, I hope will be of real interest to our audience. Thank you very much, all of you, for joining us here in Canada this morning, and of course in the UK in the afternoon. I understand all of you will be heading into a long weekend coming this weekend and Monday, so our well wishes to you. We just had our long weekend. For all of you who are attending today, the basic format is going to be, as I said, a wide-ranging discussion between Tom Greatrex and myself as the respective leaders of the nuclear associations in the UK and Canada. We also encourage questions, and I think we're certainly going to put aside some time toward the end of the hour to address some of those questions. Tom has asked that we remind everyone that they can use their chat function to list their questions, and I think both of us will be monitoring those questions as we go along, so that we can do our best to answer them. And if I may, I'll just introduce Tom for our Canadian viewers who are not as familiar with him. Tom Greatrex is the chief executive of the Nuclear Industry Association in the UK. I believe you started in 2016, right, Tom? And
yeah.
Formerly a member of parliament in the Parliament of the United Kingdom. And suitably was the shadow energy minister from 2011 to 2015 and the opposition's lead spokesman on nuclear energy, electricity market reform, smart grid and metering, carbon capture and storage, interconnection, both onshore and offshore oil and gas. He led the scrutiny of the Energy Act and the Infrastructure Act in the last parliament and served as a member of the Energy Select Committee from 2010 and 2007 to 10, was the policy advisor in the Scotland office, including on energy. So Tom, real wealth of experience there, in addition to now leading the industry association in the UK. And we here on the Canadian side are just delighted that you've taken some time this afternoon, this morning, to join us for a wide-ranging conversation in these interesting times.
Great. Yeah, well, as you say, before you read my obituary, we are certainly in some very interesting times at the moment with what's going on in the wider world, and also I suppose the agenda for civil nuclear in both of our countries and actually in many other places in the world as well.
Mm-hmm. Why don't we start there, just in recognition of the fact that we've got people from industry folks from both countries. Would you mind just giving a very high level snapshot of the sort of current state of the industry? We can leave COVID, the COVID impact to the next topic. But would you mind just providing a snapshot of the sort of dynamics within the industry in the UK right now, from a conventional plant and from maybe touch on the SMR a bit as well?
Yeah, so in the UK, well, technically in Great Britain, actually, because Northern Ireland, for these purposes, has a separate electricity grid system that's linked to the Republic of Ireland. So in Great Britain, 20% or just over 20% of the electricity that's generated each year comes from nuclear. That's still, despite a massive expansion in renewables, still is the largest output low carbon generator in the UK, and provides that electricity, as we know nuclear can and does, round the clock and round the year, depending on, doesn't make any difference what the weather's like. And that's been the case for a number of years now. However, that fleet is now getting towards the end of its lifetime. Within this decade, in the 2020s, all but one of the current power stations are due to retire. They will have reached the end of their lives after having been through, in most cases, lifetime extensions, and it's unlikely that there's any opportunity to extend those further. So we are, as we have been doing for a number of years, really, I suppose, facing a reality that we will need to replace that capacity in some way, and do that in a way which ensures that we don't end up increasing carbon emissions. To that end, we have one project under construction at Hinkley Point C in the southwest of the country, adjacent to Hinkley Point B, which is a generating station, Hinkley Point A, which is in the decommissioning process, which will provide 3.2 gigawatts, two reactors, 3.2 gigawatts of power when it's constructed, and it started construction a couple of years ago. So it's, well, maybe trying to think exactly when it started, and it's getting on for 3 years now, I think. So well underway. That is the first new build project in the UK for a generation since the late 80s, early 1990s, when Sizewell B was built. And there have been at various points a range of other projects that are in various different stages. EDF looking to potentially build further of the same reactor design in the east of the country at Sizewell. CGN, Chinese company, in the stage early, well, partway through now the assessment of their reactor design, potentially to be built in the UK as well. And Horizon, which is the Hitachi ABWR reactor design, which is underway but was being suspended a year or so ago now, whilst various issues around policy are being sorted out. And that's where we are with our current fleet and new build. But the UK is, as one of the countries that's had nuclear for the longest period of time, has quite an interesting array of decommissioning and waste management estate and challenges and work going on, particularly at Sellafield, which a number of you may well have heard of, in Cumbria. And that's probably where, despite what's happening at Hinkley, the most new build associated with civil nuclear happens in the UK is actually in terms of dealing with and managing the estate at Sellafield. So that's sort of where we are. We've got a chunk of power which is coming towards the end of its life, starting to build more, and we need to build more with our 2050 carbon commitments. And we've got an interesting and varied and in some cases challenging decommissioning estate, which gives our industry some expertise in some of those areas, just by accident of timing, where we're probably more advanced than in some other places. On SMR, there's been a lot of debate around SMR and AMR over the years. There was there is now a consortium led by Rolls-Royce and a number of other companies that are looking to develop SMR in the UK, really because I think the big push is they're easier in terms of financing to develop, and the potential that comes from rolling out a fleet of the same design internationally, and therefore modular build, factory build, etc. So that is something which is has had some support from government, and there's work going on, and that consortium are looking to take the steps in terms of finding sites to be able to develop SMR in the UK. Although the reactor design hasn't as yet gone through an equivalent of a generic design assessment process, but that's sort of, well, you know, very firmly on the horizon for activity that's going to happen soon in the UK.
So, Tom, is that, can you just you use the word consortium? Who is it a consortium of, and is there only one consortium that's pursuing this right now?
So, in the UK at the moment, there's a range of different SMR small modular. We've gone through this process of effectively characterizing a whole range of things as SMR, and then trying to desegregate them. So, there's small modular reactors and advanced modular reactors in our sort of parlance at the moment, and then there's fusion as well. And under the sort of general banner of small modular reactors and AMRs, there's a whole range of different technologies, some of which are UK companies that are active in Canada, like Moltex, for example, as well as being interested in the UK, U-Battery, which is owned by Urenco, for example. So that's more a micro reactor, really. And then the lead UK technology is Rolls-Royce, a Rolls-Royce technology adapted from versions of reactors designs that are used in submarines, but designed to be built in a modular fashion and factory built. And there is a UK SMR consortium headed by a guy some of you may well be aware of or know called Tom Sampson, who was involved previously in a company called NuGen, which was a large reactor project for Cumbria, which unfortunately didn't get to fruition. And that consortium has a whole number of different companies in it, including Atkins, SNC-Lavalin, obviously with a Canadian connection, but a number of companies with a significant UK-based who are signed as part of that consortium to be a significant part of the supply chain and the support for that project and that consortium. And it's still in the stages of seeking various policy commitments that would enable that to make some progress, although there have been quite a lot of there has been some progress on that, although not as much as we wanted. And somebody has very helpfully put up in the chat function, this is a good reminder for people to be able to keep their eye on that, that some of those companies include Nuvia, Arup, AMEC Foster Wheeler, which is now part of Jacobs now, following the merger of Jacobs and Wood, and Lango Rourke are amongst that, and the Nuclear Advanced Manufacturing Research Centre are amongst that consortium. And there's a useful link there for people to look at if they want to know more about that. Mm-hmm.
Well, Tom, that was a great overview. I mean, it's easy to see when you consider the long relationship between our countries, and given that we both nations have a long and proud history in generating nuclear power and the pedigree there, that there are these ongoing discussions and shared interest by each other's markets in being active in our respective nations. And given the level of activity that you've outlined there, both in terms of the new build and the decommissioning and now the interest and activity in small modular reactors, I guess that explains why Canada had such a strong presence in terms of delegates at your NIA UK event just in March, right before we were hit with COVID. Right, I think we had about 50 different company representatives there.
Yeah,
looking to see how we could work on our relationship and share expertise and do work in each other's markets. Did you want me to take a moment to sort of provide a snapshot for the UK industry in terms of what we're doing here in Canada?
Yeah, I think that'd be really helpful for those that won't be familiar on the call.
Okay, well, we have a major refurbishment going on right now of our nuclear fleet here in Ontario, which of course is our biggest province from a population and economy point of view. It's a $25 billion refurbishment that is taking place over a number of years. I think there are 9 years or so left to go. The industry is very strong because of that refurbishment that's going on. We're employing about 76,000 people. Contribute about $17 billion per year to our gross domestic product. And the refurbishments are being led by the two main operators here in Ontario, namely Bruce Power and Ontario Power Generation, which is the Crown-owned utility here in Ontario that owns a number of different assets, but takes care of a number of the nuclear stations. We also have nuclear power plants in the province of New Brunswick. So that foundation is the number one priority for our industry association, ensuring that goes as smoothly as possible. And right now it's on time and on budget. We're going to get to COVID and how that's impacting our respective industries, but it is providing a very, very healthy nuclear ecosystem here in Canada that we are using to bridge into the future. A lot of the discussion around the future of nuclear power here in Canada is focused on small modular reactors. And I would say that we view ourselves to be in a position to be a first mover on small modular reactors in the free world. And I say that for a couple of reasons. The central one being the level of coordination that there is among the different components of our industry and government and the regulator in terms of having a plan to develop and deploy small modular reactors. We've got lots of information that we could share on this, and I'd encourage people to go to the CNA website if they want to take a look at the Canadian small modular reactor roadmap or some of the communications that we've put out. What I will say, Tom, at this point is the small modular reactor plan here is a truly a national one. So we have four utilities from the provinces of Saskatchewan, Ontario, and New Brunswick who have agreed to a formal structure for the deployment, development and deployment of small modular reactors. You mentioned you've got SMRs, AMRs, and fusion. We look at things through the lens of stream one, stream two, and stream three. And for us, stream one are sort of those on-grid reactors that could be deployed as quickly as possible. Stream two has to do with the next generation of small modular reactors. I think I'd put, you mentioned Moltex, for example. I'd put Moltex or a terrestrial or, into that category. I shouldn't get into naming companies because we've got 12 of them going through the review and licensing process right now with our regulator. So very active from a technology provider's point of view. And we also have a third stream, stream three, which is the smaller reactors, which can be used off-grid with mining operations, indigenous communities, oil and gas extraction, etc. So all three of these are being developed in parallel, all three with a plan that is supported by the utilities and supported by Natural Resources Canada, which is our government arm, a very active champion for us within the federal government to deploy these things. They helped us make the small modular reactor, the SMR roadmap. But importantly, we now have some significant political support. So these three provinces, the premiers, the leaders of those three provinces have signed a memorandum of understanding, looking at wanting to use these technologies to help them meet the nation's and their province's carbon targets going into 2050, very similar to the UK. We have a fourth province, Alberta, which is looking very seriously at signing on. So we have that industry collaboration with the utilities. We have the provinces now politically who've signed on and are pushing for this. We have a regulator, which is less prescriptive and I think more flexible and looking at how to bring these small modular reactors in. And as I said, right now, looking at 12 different technology vendors. So this level of coordination and collaboration between these various industries, I think gives us a very good path forward on small modular reactors.
Yeah, and it's interesting. I mean, sort of mentioned the approach of the regulator, and again, a number of people on the call will be aware of this, but some might not. But there is a very similar regulatory approach between the Canadian regulator and the UK regulator, and in our case, it's called the ONR, the Office for Nuclear Regulation. And I know from our conversations and discussions with the ONR that they're talking and have been talking quite extensively and a lot with the Canadian regulator on how you assess and SMR designs and how you do that in a way which is, make sure that all of the appropriate things are dealt with, but also to appreciating it's not the same as a gigawatt scale reactor in necessarily in terms of the time it takes to get through a regulatory process. And that's quite an important factor. And it's, I suppose, another factor where there is a degree of similarity in approach and therefore, benefit from collaboration and close working between, so not just our industry, but our regulators as well.
Well, I think that's a great segue too to the what we were discussing earlier this week, Tom. Just for the folks who don't know, Tom and I signed a memorandum of understanding between our two associations. And we're looking for, I guess, the first project that we're going to do under that memorandum of understanding. And I think we had looked at this idea of whether we should jointly be sort of coordinating our approach to our respective regulators around small modular reactors as one of the things we consider doing. And that mirrors a current initiative that the Canadian Nuclear Association has with our sister association in the United States. So we're actually coordinating the development of proposals and recommendations to our respective regulators, but doing it with an eye to hoping to ensure that there's a really either joint recognition or a smooth process for the licensing and regulation of these small modular reactors. Tom, could I ask you, in light of the COVID-19, how is the industry in the UK doing, whether it's the supply chain or how is it holding up?
Well, as you can imagine, the lockdown which we've been in, which is just basically held, there's been some relaxation around the edges in the last couple of weeks. You lose track of time. It's weird, this lockdown thing. The days seem to go on forever, but the weeks go by really quickly. So trying to remember exactly how many weeks it is. I think it's maybe 10 weeks now, something like that. Yeah. So for a reasonable period of time, and during that time, in terms of our fleet, the operating fleet, they've continued generating power. The industry's been pretty good and prepared in terms of having contingency plans and in place, which were developed really for potential other previous pandemics, which never actually quite got to anything like the scale we've got now. So SARS and everything else, avian flu and things in the UK. So those plans were put into place. It means that people that don't need to physically be on a site and can work from home are working from home, and lots of people obviously doing that. And the technology, I think, has worked pretty much for all of that. But that there are enough people to be on at stations doing what they need to do with additional social distancing and testing and temperature testing, all that sort of stuff. And that's meant that not only has the electricity that's being generated continued, also actually there, as we went into that lockdown period, there were a couple of power stations that were undergoing routine maintenance periods. Those were able to continue and complete, and so that capacity is now available. So in that sense, it sort of carried on as normal. In relation to Hinkley and the construction, the decision was taken to effectively halt all but what was deemed to be the most significant pieces, aspects of work. And so the numbers of people on site have gone down from about 4,000 to about 1,000 during that period. And so inevitably some things have been paused, and that will have an impact on those bits of the supply chain and things that are due to come afterwards, although the EDF are working quite hard with that, with their suppliers about how to help manage people through that. But in our decommissioning estate, which is, as I said before, where the majority of activity happens and where the supply chain is most crucial and most involved, then again, all but essential work was put on pause. That hasn't yet been lifted. And that means that whilst there's still things going on sites around the country, there are a lot of parts of our supply chain, and particularly those that are most associated with the big sites, so the Magnox estate and Sellafield, that are currently in that sort of holding position. A number of staff have been furloughed through the government support scheme, and a number of companies have tried to, or are in the process of accessing support schemes to keep going. But we're getting to a point where the plans for how the UK comes out of lockdown and starts to ease some of those things, particularly in terms of economic activity, is pretty crucial for the supply chain and the industry and the ongoing work. And that's where we're lobbying government and involving discussions with government on trying to make that as clear and as communicable as possible, so that even if we haven't got the date on it, we know what the plans are, so people can plan accordingly. And I think that's really important to maintaining some of that skills base, which we're fortunate to have. But unforeseen events like this, and prolonged unforeseen events and disruption, you know, having a big impact on the economy more generally, and particularly in that part of our supply chain.
There's very, very strong similarities to what we're experiencing here in Canada. The industry has done a very commendable job of adapting the workforce to COVID-19, keeping the lights on for everything, including all of these critical services that we've needed, the hospitals and everything else. In Ontario, it's especially pronounced our role here, because it's about 60% of the electricity that is coming from our plants here. I think we've also, and I'm sure this is the case in the UK, but the nuclear power industry and the supply chain have proven to be well positioned to sort of give back during this crisis in terms of creating, using their production lines and their innovative practices to produce personal protective equipment and other important, services. So that's been a sort of theme of ours going through COVID-19, is just the amount of giving back that the industry has been doing. And that's the supply chain, of course, but I have to commend all of the operators, New Brunswick Power and Bruce and OPG for helping to lead the charge on that. Over the short term, because of the refurbishments that have been going on, I think the supply chain, while some have been suffering, and so I don't want to underplay that, but at the same time, the operators have been good at continuing the sort of workflow in terms of services and manufacturing, generally speaking. I think our concern, so it hasn't been as hard a short-term hit as we feared it would be. I think the developing concern, as you mentioned, Tom, is just whether or not over the medium term we're going to get things back up to full speed again and have that supply chain, not just filling back orders, but filling, future orders and things like that. So that's where we're spending a lot of our time now with the government and with the industry, looking at what those potential issues may be. I will say that one promising area, I know the OPG and Bruce Power in particular, they are, they're intent on getting back up to full speed now, and that's sort of underway. But there are discussions going on with the federal government and the provincial levels around accelerating the original timeframes of the refurbishments here, on the basis that because they're such an important contributor to the economy, that it might provide some stimulus for the economy. So that's promising. And I'd also say that the interest in small modular reactors by government has increased, which is interesting. And I think it's increased because of a recognition that this is one of the areas where Canada can develop, has an expertise that it can develop, not only to help create jobs and meet targets here, but also participate internationally in economies and help other countries meet their targets. It just checks so many boxes here in Canada that we continue to be very bullish on the support for small modular reactors. A lot of our conversations with the government right now have to do with ensuring that there's immediate support given to critical areas within that development and deployment pathway that we have, so that it doesn't get lost, because our federal budget, for example, has been delayed indefinitely. It was supposed to come out in March, and we were expecting to see a strong signal of support there from the federal government. But now that it's been delayed indefinitely, we need some sort of interim solution for the critical things. So that's a bit of a point of a focus for us right now. Tom, I mentioned this the other day when we were on a call, but I wanted to talk a little bit about nuclear as a clean energy source. And, certainly here in Canada, we did a survey recently of the various departments and ministries in the federal government, And there is a inconsistency in terms of how nuclear is viewed, which is not helpful when it comes to ensuring that the industry can avail itself of all of the policies and funding programs that are available. And so we're working on that. We're having some success. But do you have that similar issue in the UK?
Yes, broadly. I mean, I think there is an interesting disconnect between different bits of our government. The department with responsibility for nuclear is responsible for lots of other things. And if you talk, which is called BEIS, which is business, energy, and industrial strategy. And if you talk to the people that are responsible for the nuclear bit, they obviously get it and understand it. If you talk to some of the people involved in some of the wider energy bit, they don't necessarily. So whilst high-level government policy supports nuclear and being part of the future mix and in manifestos at recent elections, we've had quite a lot recently, from both major parties have sort of reaffirmed that. The policy framework is incomplete, and it's an ongoing, I suppose, battle to get people to properly understand that if you have a commitment to net zero by 2050 across the economy, not just in electricity, then your electricity, two things need to happen. Your electricity needs to be as low carbon as possible, and also the amount that you rely on polluting fuels for other activity, be that transport, housing, industry, needs to be decarbonized. And therefore the role of nuclear in what's now being called by our Committee on Climate Change firm power, i.e. that which isn't weather dependent, is a pretty significant part alongside variable output renewables. But it, I suppose it shouldn't surprise me, and it shouldn't surprise people on this call, but when you do the research about how many people understand that nuclear is low carbon, there was some polling done of younger cohort, and I'm trying to remember exactly what the younger cohort was in terms of age. I think it was under 30s, but that might not, I might not put that completely correct, but that, you know, only about 30% understood nuclear was low carbon, because what they associate with nuclear power stations is big chimneys, what cooling towers look like, chimneys look like they're burning something, and big power stations that look to people who don't necessarily know very much about it as though they're not that much different to big coal-fired power stations. And that's something which, you know, it's a bit of a shock to the system in some senses that the level of understanding is so base, but it does also underline the importance of what we need to try to do to make sure that people properly understand, firstly, that nuclear is low carbon, and secondly, that the net zero objective that both the government and have signed up to in legislation and has got a very high degree of public support requires nuclear as an integral part to be able to realise that ambition. And that's something where, you know, the some of the so-called environmental lobby groups continue with their outdated sort of opposition to nuclear power, and therefore are often at the centre of disinformation and misinformation about nuclear that we have to try to counter, that unfortunately even people within government don't necessarily have as developed an understanding as you would hope. So it's a big issue, and it's an ongoing issue, and it's something that I think in the context of the next COP26, which was obviously due to be later this year in the UK and has been postponed probably until sometime next year, and everything leading up to that, that the UK does as the one of the host countries, but also other states do, in setting out the agenda that that clean future includes nuclear as part of it. And it's really important that we marshal all our forces to be able to do that, I think.
Yeah, I completely agree. And it is shocking that such a low percentage of the population really understands that nuclear is clean to begin with. It's some significant challenges ahead of us. On our side here, the Canadian Nuclear Association, someone that we've just brought aboard, Tricia Wiegand, who's our vice president, has a very extensive background in communications and was brought aboard partly for this reason. It's in acknowledging that the nuclear industry really has got a break from a long tradition of not communicating well for various reasons, and we really have to bring this case forward. If I could just spend a couple minutes talking about this, Tom, because it's one of the most important missions that we have as an association. You know, in the Canadian context, I was brought on board partly because of my background as a renewables practitioner, right? I was a developer of renewable projects for a number of years, sat on the board of the electric utility, a large electric utility here in Ontario, and then was the head of the Solar Industries Association. And we merged the solar industry with the wind industry and created a storage division in the last couple of years that I was there. But it was this growing recognition that, you know, if we are going to meet our 2050 targets, we're not going to be able to do that on wind and solar and storage alone, right? We need a partner for intermittent sources of electricity other than coal and gas, and that's really the reason that I came over to work with the nuclear industry. And I think when I was brought on board, it was specifically to look at this issue that you brought up, which is, you know, we need to win over these environmental groups and the renewable energy groups and get some allies who are speaking on our behalf in terms of nuclear is clean. So this has been a large part of our mandate, and Tricia Wiegand has been looking at the polling numbers here in Canada and found very similar, you know, inconsistencies and lack of knowledge about nuclear. So we're really working hard on building those coalitions with the environmental groups and think tanks and renewables groups, and also putting the foundation in place through polling and other things for a broad communications campaign that I hope will change the dynamics here. The specific issue that we are looking at that I think has a lot of strategic importance in this communications effort is around clean electrification. So you mentioned it, and I'd like to know, I'd like to hear from you a little bit more about that. But in the Canadian context, we have an 80% clean electricity grid. So non-emitting electricity grid, because we've got a lot of hydro and then nuclear, then we've got solar and wind. So there's pockets that have to be decarbonized for our electricity grid, but we're starting with a good clean electricity base in many places. And, you know, frankly, Tom, we're in a situation right now where even before COVID, electricity demand was not really growing much in the Canadian economy. With COVID, we've now seen a sort of lowering of demand even further, and we'll have to see where that's going to go. It could be, you know, lowered indefinitely. We're seeing big investment coming down the pipe here for energy efficiency, which will again lower demand for electricity. And so in the Canadian context, if we want to hit our targets and we also want to see an increase in electricity demand, it's got to be clean electricity, as you said, but we have to electrify, you know, transportation, buildings, industry. We have to use that unique capability of nuclear and especially SMRs to produce, you know, heat as well as power, perhaps produce some hydrogen, use SMRs to be good partners for intermittent sources of renewables. And I think it's by electrifying those other parts of our economy that we're going to see that growth in electricity. And I really believe, in the Canadian context anyway, that small modular reactors are the actual linchpin to enabling electrification in Canada. For all sorts of reasons, electrification strategy for the nation has always been put off. But I'd say that until now, because with the advent of small modular reactors, we have a political will to use it as a tool, which is new. The SMR technology is actually favorable to working with other technologies to help with electrification. And when you combine the fact that Canada has a really carbon intensive industries around oil and gas and mining, and that SMRs can help in those areas, I think that SMRs and the Canadian expertise can really open up the pathway to a strategy for electrification.
Yeah, I think that's a really important point about the wide electrification. I mean, if you shut down your economy, then it's not a surprise that demand for power falls. And it won't be a surprise that some people then try to take advantage from that position. And, you know, we saw a little bit of a flurry of press comment a week or so ago around, well, do we actually need any nuclear? Because look how it's, we can do it all with sun and wind at the moment. But, you know, that is an artificially depressed position. And even if there are changes to working practices and things as a result, long-term changes as a result of COVID-19, I think it's unrealistic to expect that by 2050, the modelling that demonstrates if we're going to decarbonise, that therefore the distinction between energy and electricity diminishes and the amount of electricity you need as a proportion of your energy increases, even with energy efficiency. And we've had, again, not uniquely, but a whole range of different things in relation to, for example, you know, changing the types of lighting you use in streetlights, you know, which might sound small, but done across the whole of the country, as they broadly have done, has been one contributor to the fact that pre-COVID-19, our electricity demand was basically been pretty stable, or if anything, slightly falling over the last couple of years. But that isn't going to deal with how you decarbonize transport, how you deal with heating, when in the UK 80% of our heating comes from gas, for example, synthetic fuels for aviation and maritime in the future. So all those things demonstrate that, you know, 2050 and net zero isn't just about trying to have a low emissions overall range from your electricity. It's about much more than that. And I think the scale of that is something which isn't necessarily always appreciated. And it's another part of that challenge, I think. John, I'm just conscious that there's a few questions that have popped into the chat box around some of the points we were talking about in terms of perceptions. I don't know if you want to have a first go at this. Laurie was asking about, I talked about age gap in perception of nuclear, but also making the point about the gender gap and how can we or should we, in what ways should we try to address that gender gap perception and awareness of nuclear?
Well, you know, my understanding of the gender gap based on some polling, historical polling that we've reviewed and other coverage, if I'm interpreting this question right, Tom, is you know, men are more inclined to be supportive of nuclear power, and women less so, you know, for all sorts of reasons. So I recognize that this is one of the issues that we're going to have to deal with when we talk about educating the public about the technology and its uses and its safety. But I can't get into it more than that. Do you have a view on the gender gap?
I mean, certainly our polling demonstrates a similar thing, that actually the what I was talking about was in terms of understanding, but amongst the younger bit of the population, but actually opposition to nuclear amongst that portion of the population isn't necessarily as strong as it is in a sort of a slightly older group. But certainly the case that when you break it down by gender, there's both less familiarity and more, I suppose, skepticism of the value of nuclear amongst the female population in the UK. I think partly that's because it's an industry which has often been seen as a very male industry. Now that has changed significantly and started to change quite a lot amongst our workforce and in our nuclear sector deal. We have a target to get up from about, we're about just over 20 odd percent to about 40% of the workforce being female by 2030. Now that is a tough ask, but industry is working towards that. We're getting a lot more of the apprentices that are coming in to the industry in different places that are females. There's much more of a balance, and I think that's part of it, and being able to really help people understand the value of what nuclear provides in terms of opportunities, jobs, careers, skills, etc., which are not just even though they might traditionally have been seen as in male roles, But also, I think, you know, the much more significant and wider point about the environmental benefits of nuclear power. And I think that's something where perhaps some studies, I think, have shown that that's something which is tends to be something that females will pay more attention to than the males overall. And so that's, you know, it's caught up into the answer to the earlier question. But I think, you know, I notice, I'm sure you do as well, John, you know, things like Mothers for Nuclear in the US have done a very good job of being able to broaden out that support, coalition of support, from just being those people whose jobs rely on it. And I think that's really important as well. The role of civic society in this is going to be really important into the future.
Yeah, I completely agree. I noticed that, by the way, CNA has signed on by the Equal by 30 as well. And we're actively working towards that with some success. We're also seeing that the average age of the workers in the nuclear industry, aside from becoming more diverse, both by gender and heritage, we're also seeing a younger population average age is shaping up now. I think we're down to the low 40s now, which has been continually getting younger, which has been helpful. I noticed that Evan Bull Jones had made a comment, but also a question about politicians and essentially their the sort of support that they need to see from stakeholder groups in the public in order to make supportive decisions about nuclear. So, as a former member of Parliament, Tom, what is that? What is that dynamic, and how? You know, how does it, these MPs are generally quite informed, but they look to the support from the various audiences to whether or not they can actually get behind something, right? So.
Yeah, well, I would slightly hesitate about how well informed politicians are generally, which isn't slight on politicians particularly. It's just a fact that if you're an elected politician with a constituency or a district, of people to represent, then unless there's something which has a significant impact in that area, or it's an area you've already got an interest in, it's impossible to be have a level of understanding and detailed expertise on a whole wide range of issues at once, even though you might want like to give that impression sometimes when you're being interviewed on things. It just isn't possible. So you tend to find that there are politicians, so in the issues around energy, for example, either if you've got a constituency that is significantly impacted, then you'll have an interest, or a company's based there, or significant companies based there. Or if you've got a personal policy interest in an area, but the vast majority won't have any. And, you know, in the time that I was in Parliament, there was out of 650 MPs, there's probably about 30 odd who had really an interest in energy policy, you know, across all parties, and very little amongst the rest of it. So the messages, I don't think, need to be really much more developed or sophisticated than the messages that you use with the general public more widely, actually. But you're right. I think what politicians all rely on votes, and so they will want to get behind something which sounds and seems popular, will be hesitant, even if they know better or think better, to anything that might be unpopular, just to keep your head down a bit. I think the catalyst for changing that if we do the things we need to do in the right way, is the turning the sort of high level commitment to net zero into reality, is where I think there's a real opportunity to re-engage a whole range of people who perhaps we didn't engage with in the past, or we did and then haven't done for a while, or we sort of frankly wrote off as being not worth paying any attention to. Completely. To be able to, it's not really re-educate. I mean, we've got running this campaign called Rediscover Nuclear, which is really about saying that things you might have thought you knew or heard about nuclear in the past, well, even if some of them might have been accurate, actually would have been at a time before, really, many people were talking about carbon emissions or net zero, or how do you power all the electric vehicles that we're going to have if we're going to decarbonize transport, et cetera, et cetera. Yeah. And putting that into that context that helps people understand the value, the not just the economic value, but also the environmental value of having nuclear as an integral part of that mix. And that's something which is, you know, politicians start to say things and repeat things and agree with things when they've heard them so many times that they become familiar. And, you know, that's why it's an ongoing process and something that you just have to do in a way that is incessant and repetitive and constant and consistent. Because if not, then we can't expect the basis of, you know, a technical briefing note from a company in someone's constituency for someone then to be therefore ticking a box of someone who's informed and is therefore going to be an advocate. It doesn't work like that. It's a lot more intensive effort than that.
I entirely agree. And, you know, before going into COVID, I think what was feeding into that dynamic was just this realization with our 2050 targets, this increased anxiety around climate change, right, that we were seeing globally and in both of our populations. But it was being combined with a recognition that we really aren't making progress fast enough, right? So this growing public recognition and anxiety of around climate change combined with a growing recognition that we're not moving fast enough creates an opportunity for nuclear. I think COVID-19 it could potentially slow that down a bit depending on where people's focus goes, whether it's the environment or the economy or health related issues as we get through this. So we'll have to watch that carefully. But I also think that SMRs create a great hook to restart or rediscover nuclear, as you mentioned, right, Tom? Because they're new, they're innovative, they've got a lot of aspects to it which can create a new conversation. We have such great engagement here in the chat room. It's kind of, and I know we're running short on time. So should we try to address a couple more of these? Or
yeah, I'm just looking at Bob's point about, and it's something I didn't really mention in relation to the UK. I was asking about, you know, the economic recovery. So in Canada, Bruce Powers, and you touched on this, John. You know, impact in terms of getting the economy back and up and running again, there's a significant role that our industry can play. I mean, that is certainly something that we have been talking to and pushing government on, really, that the government is very clear that as we come out of aspects of the controls that have been put around because of the COVID-19, that we try to minimize length of period of the economic downturn, which has obviously been significant in the last few weeks. And, you know, trying to get that more of a V shape than a U shape is going to be a big challenge. And I think government in the UK, despite the ideological positions that people may have taken pre this, understand the government has to be a big role in that. At the same time, we obviously do have this wider agenda in relation to carbon emissions and climate that, I mean, it makes a lot of sense for low carbon technologies we're going to need to be effectively to be prioritized in terms of activity and getting on with things. And in the UK context, there's stuff that that's happening, but to move that much further forward needs some other policy changes. It needs a financing mechanism that enables, for example, projects, whether it be that Horizon or EDF Sizewell, beyond Hinkley to progress. There's an energy white paper which has been promised in the UK for probably getting on for a year now. That needs to be, I understand it is being rewritten, but that needs to be published relatively soon and needs to be clear about the impact of the energy industry and being able to stimulate and produce economic growth and activity and skills that are going to be required for the long term. So there is a lot in here. We don't have a retooling and economic recovery council in quite the same way, but it's certainly a big part of the agenda and the story going forward, as Bob suggests.
I'm just looking here at, first of all, I wanted to react to that, Tom, especially on the note of, you know, where are we going as we go forward. that we don't have a white paper on energy, but we've been promised basically an electrification plan here for quite a while, and we really need a national energy strategy. So I'm hoping that the dynamics that are being created now because of COVID, and they're quite complex, as I'm sure they are in the UK, but you know, we've got a very important oil and gas industry here that's suffering quite a bit in Western Canada, and when you take that suffering combined with you know, the fact that we want to move towards a low carbon economy or a net zero economy here in Canada by 2050, it's creating all sorts of tensions and I think opportunities for SMRs. But yeah, we really have to get our head around our energy strategy for Canada. I just wanted to go back. I see Nigel had pointed out something that I should have brought up. We talked about closing the gender gap, and we also touched on youth. One of the things that the Canadian Nuclear Association has done, which has kind of turned out to be fortuitous, given that the schools have closed down until next fall, is we launched something or relaunched something called Teach Nuclear. And it's a complete curriculum for grade 7 to grade 12 schools here in Canada, broken down by province and grade. And it's completely relaunched now and is getting some huge take up because of the interest in doing virtual teaching by various teachers and the fact that it produces the units of learning. So if you have some interest, Tom, and we can connect our folks together and maybe share that information. It's a great way of reaching out and educating the younger groups.
Yeah, I'm aware of some of that work from conversations I've had before, but yeah, I've got the link now. That's really helpful. Thank you.
Okay. So it's we've just come upon the hour here, and I guess we better respect people's time. I really am very grateful and pleased for all the interactions and questions and comments we've had here. But Tom, did you have anything to say in closing?
Well, that's the thing I just wanted to finish on is obviously, John, we have recently back in March, although like you say, it feels like a long time ago, signed a memorandum of understanding between CNA and the NIA. I think, you know, the nature of the discussion today has demonstrated just quite how, you know, both the number of similarities of circumstance that we have and also some of the shared challenges. And I think, you know, I'm very keen, and I know you are, that actually we take advantage of those for the benefit of the companies that, from all the people that are on the call and people from civic society in Canada and the UK as well can benefit. And that's something which, you know, I think maybe if industry is showing the lead on that, that can help to ensure that the government continues to do that as well between governments, because there's a lot actually that we can learn from each other. And I hope actually one of the things that we learn from what we're going through at the moment is that having, even when you have to shut your borders and send people home and close the schools and everything else, that the route out and the route to a more fulfilled society is through collaboration and cooperation across countries and across nations. And this is just one area where I think we can demonstrate the value of that to everybody. It doesn't need to be something which is seen as being against the interests of a country. Actually, it's in the country's interest to do so.
Completely agree, Tom. I don't think I could add anything to that, and I'm very much looking forward to continuing our discussions and finding out how our industries and nations can help each other in these coming weeks and months.
Great. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thanks all.